What's up, motherfuckers, and welcome to episode 118 of the Good Kraken Podcast. I am one of your hosts, Arnell Pearson, alongside the little cherry blossom himself, the Crimson Chin, the Garrick B. Eaton. What's happening, baby?
Such an aggressive start.
You know, listen, man, it's been an aggressive kind of fucking couple weeks, you know what I'm saying?
Like, we just gotta let it go. I feel that, man. Dude. Pepsi tricked the shit out of me, bro.
Okay, yeah, we gotta talk about this. We have to uncover the fuckery that just happened right now. So, ladies and gentlemen, Garrick here goes, "Hey, I got this exciting new drink, this exciting new beverage, and I'm going to try it with you." And I was like, "Lit, let's do it, doggy dog." He opens it, he takes a sip, and he says,
"This is flat vanilla Pepsi, dude. They straight up got me. They got me. Look at that can. Look at that cream colored can. It's got a good little can presentation." Yeah. I literally picked it up and I was just like, "Okay, new Pepsi. I'll give it a go. And then it's got little instructions on the side of the can, right? It's like, it says 1, chill can. 2, pour hard. 3, admire and enjoy. Apparently, yeah, it's a pretty drink to look at. I put it in a fucking Starbucks cup because...
Sure.
But this literally, it just tastes like flat vanilla Pepsi, dude. I'm feeling a little bamboozled. I'm upset.
The fucking Mormon says, "Tell me you've never had a Guinness without telling me you've never had a Guinness."
I've never had a Guinness.
Saint, you need to buy the jewelry. You need to buy the jewelry, Saint. Garrick, how are you, dog? How's your week going so far?
So I played hooky yesterday from work to take care of some errands and things. Just kind of rest and recuperate. I did some other things too, which I'll talk about later on.
Sure.
But, dude, I work today. My God, I didn't get to sit down long enough to do any meaningful paperwork. It feels like the freaking end of the school year, man. It feels like the end of the school year. It's just so busy. I feel like I'm running around like a chicken with my freaking head cut off, dude. I'm tired. I'm tired.
Yeah.
I have a week and a half left. And then I have a week off and then I start summer school and I get to do it all over again. But hey.
Hey, let's go. Yeah. So you do summer school shit too. Is what you do that as well?
Yeah, these motherfuckers don't pay me year round, so I gotta make money in the summertime. So they give me some hours in the summer. It's usually I don't know, I don't mind the work during the summertime. It's actually pretty chill for the most part. So
Yeah. For people at home that don't know, Garrick is a teacher. He's a teacher guy.
Of sorts, yes.
He's a teacher guy of sorts. Yeah, he's a kind of teacher guy. That's kind of what he is. Saint wants to know, do you make more on the summer hours?
No, during the summer, it's still my regular hourly wage.
Mm.
And then the way it works is my position's kind of special where I work. It's all grant funded. My position's grant funded.
Right.
Because it's a pilot program. And I sound so fancy when I say that. That's what it is.
I love that for you. Yeah.
And so I work in this pilot program. So basically during the summertime, they're like, "All right, you have X amount of hours to spend on, this X amount of work over this many days."
Sure.
And so I can use that basically I just converse with my people and they're like, "All right, you can work this schedule," and I'm like, "All right, I want to work this schedule this day, use my hours this way," and then I just spend them, and then once they're gone I just get to enjoy the rest of my summer and go back to school in the fall.
Okay. Saint says, "Okay, because someone I know gets higher pay if she teaches during summer, which it was the standard." There you go.
School districts have they have a pretty wide array of shit they're just allowed to do on their own. And it's definitely, there's not a lot of consistencies. Even with my neighboring school districts and stuff, it's they run really differently. It's wild.
Yeah, no, I get it, man. It sucks. All you teachers should be fucking paid more, man. I'll tell you, no matter what kind of teacher you are, whether you're a kind of teacher, a not kind of teacher, a full on teacher, you definitely should get paid more. I'll tell you that. Now, you guys at home are probably wondering where Devin is at. But we're not talking about Devin today, because tonight we're talking PlayStation, not quite cutting it. You like her when she's angry. And a groovy, groovy review and much, much more, because this is a good Kraken podcast. Your choice for all the nerdy video game and pop media news, reviews, and discussions that you want to hear. Live every Tuesday at 7 p.m. and Saturday at 12 p.m. If you're riding this wave, you can head on over to patreon.com/goodkrakenshow, where you can get a chance to submit questions and topics to the show. You can get exclusive post-show content, and you can also have early access to episodes before they go live on podcast and video services across the digital sea. But if you've emptied your pockets for the latest and greatest entertainment, that is totally fine. You can watch us record the show live right here at twitch.tv/goodkrakenshow. If you have Amazon Prime, you also have Twitch Prime. And we'd love for you to give that to us to help keep us pushing content out for all of you listening or watching at home. But you can also support us by going to our YouTube channel, by clicking that beautiful bell and big red button, or by subscribing to our podcast channel by searching Good Kraken with an exclamation mark and leaving a review there. Garrick!
What's up, Doug?
Doggy dog. We have some captain's orders, my friend. First off, this week's podcast rollout is going to be a little bit weird. Why, you might ask? Because Garrick and I fundamentally suck as human beings. More specifically, me. And I completely fucking forgot one very special
like,
episode.
Hey, yo, man. I'm going to be like, I'm not the one who didn't upload the shit to the drive. Okay.
That's what I had to backtrack. I had to backpedal a little bit. Like, more specifically, me. It's been a long week, okay? Saturday's episode with Michael Hyam will be up tomorrow morning for the public for you guys. Tonight's episode, we're going to try to get in as soon as physically possible. It might end up landing on Thursday instead.
We're doing our best.
You got instead for you guys. So just we're figuring out. Okay, we've all got a bunch of moving things going on in our lives. All right, Garrick's a teacher guy. I'm a fat guy. Devin's a not here guy. We're trying. Okay, we're fucking trying out here. Okay. Secondly, please join our Discord so that you can be involved in some of the movie watch-alongs we've been doing lately. Anything from the other night, you guys did Dogma. You guys watched Dogma together. Yep. We did the entirety of Moon Knight all across the board for watch-alongs with you guys. We'll probably end up doing She-Hulk. We'll probably end up doing Miss Marvel. Lots and lots of fun stuff that we
Obi-Wan
do
Obi-Wan Kenobi.
Obi-Wan. We'll do some Obi-Wan, I'm sure. Like, there's lots of fun stuff to do in our Discord. It's specifically dropping memes into our meme channel, because we love people that drop memes into our meme channel. You know what I'm saying? Josh out here doing the motherfucking thing. Garrick, my guy, tell the people at home, what do we got next?
But we have some news. The Helm.
I love this consistent pattern that you and I have had, where like we've had a couple episodes now where it's just you and I, and because of such, we just have very rich crackhead energy every time it's you and I, because we just get to do whatever the fuck we want now, right?
Everything, yeah, it gets a little, you're like, what's going on? You're like, everything's a little panicky, don't worry about it, it's fine.
It's fine, it's fine, it's fine, it's fine, squawk, squawk, squawk. Garrick, give the people the first two news stories today, my guy. What do we got?
I scrolled too far. Sorry. That's fine. It's everything's fine. Don't worry about it. Everything's cool. I got it. Ubisoft Plus coming to new PlayStation Plus service. This is coming from Matt Perslow at IGN. Ubisoft Plus will first be available on PlayStation in the form of Ubisoft Plus Classic, which comes bundled with PlayStation Plus Extra and Premium tiers. This version of Ubisoft Plus features a curated selection of popular games, quotes, 27 available at launch, and that will include Assassin's Creed Valhalla, The Division, and For Honor. Ubisoft Plus Classics will, God, they're really, really, they're making sure called Ubisoft Plus.
Uh-huh.
Ubisoft Plus Classics will be available from when the new version of PlayStation Plus launches June 13th in America and June 23rd in Europe. While Ubisoft has now officially announced the service, it was semi-revealed when Sony recently announced that Assassin's Creed Valhalla would be a part of the new PlayStation Plus service. Other games coming to the first 27 include Child of Light, Far Cry 3, Blood Dragon. Far Cry 4, Steep. South Park, The Fractured Butthole. I tried.
You were supposed to separate the two words.
I did.
You like leaned into it. You're like, oh, here we fucking go. The Fractured Butthole.
I tried. Anyways, The Crew 2, Trials Rising, Watch Dogs, and Werewolves Within.
Garrick. Outside of the Fractured Butthole, okay? Does this not kind of give off Fractured Butthole vibes to you too? Because this has me stressed the fuck out, man.
Dude, like, I don't... the thing that's confusing to me about this is so... Ubisoft Plus will be a part of PlayStation Plus's new subscription, but Assassin's Creed Valhalla is already available on the regular PlayStation Plus. You don't need the Ubisoft subscription, but if you have the Ubisoft subscription, which is included in your PlayStation Plus, you have access to Valhalla, not once, but twice for some reason.
Twice the Valhalla, you know?
So you can spend not only 120 hours of watching cutscenes, but 240 incredible hours watching
wonderful life changing hours of watching
cutscenes.
Yeah.
Dude, I don't understand. They roll one thing out at a time, you guys. Like, haven't even launched. You're announcing things in a really weird pace. This is just getting like. Did you see their classics catalog that they had listed recently that kind of came along with this?
Yes, that goes along with PlayStation Plus's new ordeal, and that's kind of, like, the part about this, too, that fucking weirds me out so hard, man, because it's, like, I see these things, I see this information, I see the spreadsheets, I see the announcements, I see the font on the screen, I see Ubisoft Plus, game, but the bottom line here is that for whatever reason, PlayStation just refuses to do what Xbox Game Pass is doing. And for whatever God-given fucking reason, they thought that having Ubisoft Plus was going to make the difference. Having South Park the Fractured Butthole, it was going to make a difference in people wanting to buy this, right? Like, listen, I don't care what anybody has to say. Not enough people played Trials Rising to give a fuck about this. Okay.
What the fuck is Trials Rising?
Nobody get like I don't like how was this a selling point to them? We signed up for Ubisoft Plus when we got Rainbow Six Extraction on Xbox. Like, how is this a selling point? I don't understand do we care about this? I don't fucking care about this. Like
not at all. I don't even understand. I am going to end up most likely keeping like my PlayStation Plus at like just the base original $9.99 subscription level because I don't know what the fuck I get with all this other stuff. And like the classic catalogs was impressive. There was no PlayStation 2 or 3 games. It was all original PlayStation stuff. And that's rad, but there was no variety. Variety. And like maybe this is me just kind of being a stickler, but have you noticed that like this hasn't been like marketed well? It just all looks very businessy. Like there's no presentation or showmanship. I don't know. Maybe that's just like the guy in me that likes to like, if you want me to consume, make it pretty and give me a reason to want to consume it. And like, I don't feel that way with like this new PlayStation Plus. I just feel like they're just dropping like business sheets in front of my face. And I'm like, I get this shit all day at work. This doesn't get me like excited for your stuff.
Yeah. Well, and then like, if it's not like a business fucking spreadsheet, it's just like a screen cap of like a black screen with font on it. And I'm just like,
black screen and white font. You're just like, I couldn't tell this was a PlayStation like announcement. It just looks like some dude like copy pasted some crap off Reddit and then tweeted it.
Well, it looks undeniably like one of those like I'm a famous person and I made a fuck up, and so I'm publicly apologizing. This is my iPhone Notes app like apology. Like, yeah, dude. It's, like that's what it comes off as. And so when I see it, I'm just like
at the bottom of the screen app, it just says it's just like the long tweet URL.
Yeah, twit longer. Yeah, I fucking love. they're like, sorry, we fucked up PlayStation Plus. Anyways, beyond the aesthetics of their announcements, right? That just I cannot for the life of me like figure out how in the world they thought that this was like, this is it. Dude, we fucking nailed it, man. We fucking
this
did
is
it.
The parallel like, move.
They had their fucking like they had their corporate meeting and these dudes in fucking suits are kind of like, guys, we fucking did it. We did it. And they all stood up and they started clapping together, right? They're like, oh, there's gonna be the best decision that PlayStation's made in fucking years, right? Fucking wrong, man. I don't understand this. Like, they're offering nothing. They're offering nothing. Fucking jack shit, dude. Like, as a person with a PS5, okay? And that's not to dick swing. As a person with a PS5, they offer nothing to me. This gives me nothing. Like, I don't care. Yeah, thank you, Garrick. I don't care that you perplex learning me. I don't give a shit about a majority of this because a majority of these games, like, a lot of people still just already have their PS4s. It's and they don't care about this shit. They don't care if they got to play Crash Bandicoot again when there's been a fucking remaster. They don't care about, like, the original play. There's one PSP game, dog. There's one PSP game that you get for free out of this. And I can't fucking figure
and
it out,
and it's not Monster Hunter 2 Freedom Unite. What
exactly.
The fuck, guys?
Exactly.
Like, come on.
Exactly.
Dude, honestly, this should worry people. Ernell and I are the PlayStation guys of the GK crew.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, as PlayStation, like, owners and consumers, like, this does nothing for me. I'm not going to invent. I feel no need or incentive to, like, up my tier of PlayStation Plus whenever that decides to launch. And, like, I don't feel the need. Like, there's no draw. Like, I feel like I'm not getting it. I'll keep my Xbox Game Pass.
Yeah. Yeah. And when the day comes that they start giving some shit out that's actually a better fucking deal, sure, I'll sign up for it then. You know, but for now, I am not in the least bit fucking worried or interested in doing this. I'll pay for the base PlayStation Plus for me to be able to play with people online. That's all I fucking need. I could yep. not care less about the rest of the stuff that comes along with this. It's like Morbid says, in a parallel multiverse, this was a successful business move. In a parallel universe that, like, Game Pass didn't exist, sure. Sure, that's a good start. You know, like, that's okay, sure. You know, and then Game Pass would come out. And we'd be like, oh, fuck, it gets better. You know what I mean? Like, but this was, we're not in that parallel universe, Garrick. We're not living in some weird fucking dystopian world that this is happening. However, we do have some news about some dystopian worlds, and you better give it to them, Doggy Dog.
Absolutely. Black Mirror Returns, new series in the work at Netflix, and this is coming from Manori Ravindran at Variety. It's been almost 3 years since season 5 of this the dystopian drama premiered on the streaming service in June 2019, but sources indicated that a new anthology series of Black Mirror is shaping up, and casting is now underway. While details about specific stories are being kept under lock and key, Variety understands that season 6 will have more episodes than season 5, which was a compromise of just 3 installments and starred Andrew Scott, Anthony Mackie, and I will butcher that name. I will try my best, but I will butcher it.
Yahya Abdul-Mateen II.
Yep, that would have been too much for my dyslexic white ass. So Topher Grace and Miley Cyrus. See if I would have read that before, I probably would have been okay. But, you know, that's fuck me for not reading the article beforehand, right?
Sure. No, that's okay.
A source close to the production tells Variety that the latest season is even more cinematic in scope, with each installment being treated as an individual film. This is, of course, in line with recent seasons of Black Mirror, for which each episode usually exceeded 60 minutes and had incredibly high production values.
God damn it, Garrick, let's fucking go!
Admittedly, I have not seen Black Mirror at all. I've seen it, I know about it, I've heard nothing but awesome things, but I have not seen it.
Garrick! Garrick!
I know.
Oh, God, Garrick.
I know.
What the fuck, man? No, that's your next fucking project. God damn it. You need. How are you not. Have you not watched this show? A single episode? A single episode.
Dude, okay. Morbid says, Morbid in the chat, he says, let's watch it, Garrick. I haven't seen it either. Gio, you know what to do. Set it up. We'll get going.
Gio and I will watch it. Gio, we'll you goddamn it. You guys better fucking watch the show. I swear to God. Gio doesn't have a goddamn podcast about the shit, Garrick. You do. You do. Okay.
Do your homework.
This show is so fucking good, man. I can't believe that you haven't experienced this. There's so many good stories in this fucking show. So many good stories, dude, because it's effectively like the Twilight Zone, like a modern day Twilight Zone, right? Like every episode is a different story. What makes it special is that there is theory that, well, it's not necessarily theory. They sort of insinuate it. That's all in the same world. It's the same universe that this is all happening in. And it is just impeccable storytelling, impeccable production work. Like they're like, dude, there's two episodes that have won awards because of how good they are. Like this show is fucking impeccable, man.
All right, I'll get on it.
I'm telling you, man.
I actually do need a new show to kind of watch through. So this will give me something to do for a while. It seems.
There you go.
Given that the episodes are pretty long and there's 5 seasons of it.
There you go. Yeah. And honestly, like you will get so sucked into the story that the stories that like it won't feel like an hour. Like it zooms by pretty quick. And there are some episodes that feel a little bit filler-ish at first, but stick it out. Because like each, and you have to watch them consecutively because each episode sort of introduces like a new piece of technology that you will see in another episode later on. And that's why they sort of exist in the same universe, because this piece of technology carries on into another story from another thing that they introduce another piece of technology. And there's another weird thing that happens, so on and so forth. So
they like, they leave like breadcrumb clues. Like,
yeah, just like
shows.
Tiny little Easter eggs and stuff. Yeah. So like, for example, like one of the first episodes, in this world, everybody has like cameras in their eye. And it's actively recording their life and everything that they do through this camera that's in their eye, right? But they can also sort of use it as like a UI hub in their life to fast forward and see moments and so on and so forth. Well, after that episode is done, they show it again. And like 3 episodes later, someone just using it really quickly because they're like, oh, I remember that. Let me go back and check that really quick. And they just do that really fast, right? So it's not like a pivotal thing, but it's like
it's just like a quick, you're like, oh, this is like, it's a tie-in here.
Yeah, dope. Yeah, cool. So I can kind of get that concept, right? But god damn it, man. There's one episode specifically that, like, if you have any heart in that fucking body of yours, you will cry because this episode is so fucking beautiful, man. I'm telling you, dog. I'm telling you. I'm excited for you to... god damn it.
I'll check it out. I'll check it out. Absolutely.
God, man. Now, Garrick, we have some very, very sick fucking news up next, guys. Fall Guys is free to play and coming to Nintendo Switch and Xbox on June 21st. This comes from Antonio G.D. Benedetto over at The Verge. God damn, this is exciting. The game, which first launched on PlayStation and PC, was initially set to be released on Switch and Xbox last summer, but it will finally be arriving on those platforms soon. A dedicated PS5 version of the game will be released on June 21st as well. Progression will be shared across platforms, and you'll be able to make cross-platform parties. Developer Mediatonic, which is now owned by Fortnite maker Epic Games, revealed the move to free-to-play, the new versions, and a whole host of updates on the way for Fall Guys in a video published Monday. These changes include an upcoming map editor, free skins for Xbox Game Pass subscribers, and that players will be able to exchange crowns for kudos, which can be used in the in-game store. Sorry, I had a weird fumble on the two ends there. And kudos is the in-game currency. Existing players who have played the game before its free-to-play change will get a legacy pack of perks, including 3 outfits, a title, and a nameplate, and access to a premium season pass. Also, pre-registering on the Epic Games site will unlock communal milestone perks for the game. Dude, fuck off, Morbid. Garrick, dude. Oh, boy. I know you and I were about this goddamn game, man. I know you were about this fucking game just as much as I was. I played the shit out of this fucking game, Garrick.
Fucking love Fall Guys, dude. I love Fall Guys. I'm so stoked to be seeing this coming to Xbox. especially because that's like my new kind of living space in the mm-hmm. game world. Mm-hmm. I live on my Xbox and I game on my Xbox, and like I've heard like there were things confirmed like crossplay and like being able to like previous owners will get like the bonus stuff and they'll be able to carry mm-hmm. over your stuff. Mm-hmm. Dude, it's gonna be gonna be amazing. And dude, June 21st, that's close. That's close. It's just a month away.
Dude, I'm saying, man. I'm fucking saying, dude. This is going to be so sick. You guys know we're doing a gameplay stream of this. Like, we have to do Fall Guys.
100%. It's happening.
It's undeniable. Lobby, let's it's go. Going to happen. We're going to get sweaty and gross and toxic. It's going to be the fucking funniest piece of content you guys have seen in a long time. This game is so fucking lovely in every way, shape, and form. And, honestly, I have a gut feeling that when you die and go to heaven, the first game you play is Fall Guys. All right, that's how Absolutely. Confident I feel about this goddamn game. Now, Garrett, how many crowns have you gotten? You know what I mean? Like, how many crowns have you earned for yourself?
It has been quite the long minute since I've loaded up Fall Guys. Best of my memory, I think I've got 3. Mm-hmm. I didn't have a ton. Mm-hmm. I got 3.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Now there's now a lot of stuff where you can kind of just earn crowns through like a battle pass sort of thing. They do give you crowns. As far as earned crowns, I too have only gotten 3. I never got past the three mark.
Those are pure dubs.
Just goddamn right fucking joy.
Just clutching it. Clutching it on Volcano Mountain, dude.
Damn it, man. God damn it, this is a good game. And you guys at home better be prepared because we're coming in hot. We're coming in hot to play some Fall Guys, and you guys can play with us. It's like up to like a 50-person lobby in that fucking game, man. You can roll in here and just being Fall Guy,
absolutely. I'm gonna be doing practice matches. I'm gonna be getting warmed up.
Man, I'm telling you.
See if there's any new game modes I haven't played.
Goddamn, dude. I'm telling you. And the maps have only gotten better, and then they're now doing the thing we can custom make a map.
Dude.
Epic, you motherfucker. You know what I'm saying? You just gave us a gift.
Dude, Ernell and I are just going to be, it's going to be like 4 in the morning, and we're just going to be like custom making like the official GK Good Kraken map.
Yep. I'm telling you, dog, it's going to be so good, dude. I can't wait. And you guys at home can't wait either. I bet, man. In the meantime, y'all, we next up have some good old breaking news. Let's fucking go. Ladies and gentlemen, She-Hulk, Attorney at Law, gets a release date. This comes from Rebecca Valentine back at IGN again. And she says this: today, Marvel finally gave us a lengthy look at upcoming series now titled She-Hulk, Attorney at Law, showing off Tatiana Maslany's portrayal of Jennifer Walters in earnest and dropping a release date of August 17th. Aside from some seemingly accidental teases earlier this year, this is the first full look we've gotten at Maslany in the role, as well as a more full look at the character of Walters and the comedic juxtaposition of her role as She-Hulk with her goals to be a serious lawyer. We also get a look at Mark Ruffalo returning as Bruce Banner, handing off the Hulk role to a reluctant but powerful Walters as she comes to terms with her powers and her intersection with her personal life and career. Okay. Garrick, I have to know. You saw the trailer. What'd you think?
I did see the trailer. This is going to be different. Mm-hmm. I think the superhero part is going to take a little bit of like a backseat. I think we're going to see maybe a little bit more WandaVision-y sort of like presentation. It very much looks kind of like a dramedy. Like show, like based around, you know, like She-Hulk and like her wanting to be an attorney. It looks like it's actually going to be pretty clever, like a quite clever show. It looks like it's going to use quite a lot of CGI this time around.
Yeah.
And we'll see how that pans out, because I feel like this one's definitely going to have like the heaviest usage of CGI across the ones that I've seen so far, just based off of the trailer, of course. I'm interested to see where it goes, though. It's definitely got like sort of like a I don't want to say this and sound assholey, So correct me if I am, but like girl powery, like women empowerment. There we go.
Yeah,
it's like it has like a women empowerment vibe. I was trying to find the right words.
Right.
But
right,
like, fair. And so like I'm, yeah, it has like a women empowerment sort of vibe. And I don't know, it looks like it's just going to be kind of a witty, like a very witty show. I'm interested to see what they do with it. I know jack all about She-Hulk, like as a character in the comics. So this will be kind of like a fresh introduction to me.
Yeah, I mean, like I too like have very little idea about much anything with She-Hulk besides the fact that she's a lawyer. And I, after seeing the trailer, man, to be honest, I'm a little worried, like, because like there's some stuff in it that like I was like, okay, cool, like that's dope. There's some other stuff that was kind of like I kind of wish they would have made She-Hulk a little more Hulk than she. You know what I mean? A part of me wishes that we got like just like the same sort of equivalent that we got with Bruce Banner's Hulk, but in this, and it, what was She-Hulk? And it's, I don't know. Like I saw this picture someone posted after the trailer dropped. Like everyone's blowing up the fuck about it, right? And it was this diagram that showed like a hero and like their like woman counterpart, right? So it showed like Superman and like Superwoman, right? And then it showed like like a troll, like troll thing from a video game. It showed like a troll version of like a female troll, right?
I know exactly big where this shit's going.
And then it showed Hulk, and then it just showed like a woman in a bikini, and she was green, and it was
dude, it's like World of Warcraft, like male versus female orcs, and you're just like, why?
Yeah.
Why is that female orc so goddamn motherfucking thick? You're like, I'm just out here trying to get my rotation right, man. What is up?
Well, and like, I kind of just wish that they made this She-Hulk more thick. Like, and I don't mean thick in like the, oh, she got cake. I mean thick in like,
but like
she doesn't really get bigger. She doesn't get bigger. Like, she gets taller, I guess. Like, sure, yeah, like, yeah, her limbs, like, got longer, but like they didn't make her. But it's all
very
like
proportionate, right? Like,
yeah,
she doesn't look Hulk. But the thing is like, if I remember, like most of like her comic book stuff, she wasn't. This is more or less what she looked like in the comics too.
Yeah, and
it's that same sort of like whack. It's like the opposite. It's like, remember the, you know, like your villain thing, like your villain cliche that like you hate, like with Marvel, like where they just parallel the villain
fighting this yourself, like, right?
They do they're doing like the exact same thing with like the female counterparts. I think the only one that hasn't like that's gotten like a better just like Hawkeye like did pretty good,
right?
The female counterpart, but like that's different because that like it's just a human and a human, so like you don't have to like change it up to parallel the character appropriately. You
change your outfit,
you
can, right?
Like, exactly, yeah. And their personalities differentiate enough that it's okay. But like, yeah, it'll be interesting to see because like there were no angry or like Hulk out moments in the trailer.
Exactly.
Like
none of that. Right.
So
I don't know. I mean, I'm cautiously optimistic, obviously, because you know Marvel's yet to really fail us. So it's like I trust them. I trust that they're going to deliver something that's at least going to be a lot of fun. Because at the very, very, very least, the trailer showed me something that could be fun. And I'm here for that. Just like Miss Marvel's trailer, it just looked like a lot of fun. Like, I didn't necessarily need it to be, like, any certain way. It looks like it could have some moments that'll make us feel some kind of fucking way, I'm sure. But there was something about this one specifically that I was like, I can't get a read on, like, what kind of tone they're trying to go for here, right? Because a part of it feels like dramedy, and then another part of it feels like sitcom-y, and then another part of it feels like actual like Marvel, right? But it's like few and far between, and so it's like I can't figure out like what exactly they're trying to go for here. And I guess, you know, we'll have to find out when it comes out, you know what I mean?
I guess I don't know, I'm kind of cautiously optimistic. We'll see.
It'll be fun. It's always fun with Marvel, you know what I'm saying?
Always
fun with Marvel, and it's always fun when we move on to our next segment. We're not moving on to our next segment yet, because before we do, I want to remind everybody that they can support us over on patreon.com/goodkrakenshow, where they can get early access on this episode before it goes public. They can write on the show and they can get this episode ad free. But if you're hearing this, you are not on our Patreon, my friend. So for now, here's a word from our sponsors. This piece of good cracking content is brought to you by Glide mouse pads. The world is changing, and the demand for PC gaming and work from home setups has never been as wild as it is right now. Having the best of the best in PC accessories only makes it easier to get your work done before you jump right back in to the fray of the digital sea. And Glide knows exactly how to make that happen for you. Glide Mouse Pads is the future industry leader in mouse pads, offering beautiful, smooth, waterproof products made with eco-friendly materials and non-slip rubber in a variety of sizes that are guaranteed to help you get that next win. I've got one of these bad boys in my office at work. I've got one here at my desk right now. Devin's got one. Xander's got one. This bad boy is silky smooth, silkier and smoothier than even the silkiest of smoothiest of smoothies or soy milk or what have you. You can go to glidemousepads.com right now and use code Kraken for 15% off the Founders Edition mouse pad in every size available. Again, that's code K-R-A-K-E-N, Kraken, for 15% off any Founders Edition mouse pad today. Our next sponsor is Rogue Energy. Late nights are pretty much commonplace for all content creators, and anyone here at GK can attest that late nights are kind of our only nights. Luckily for us, though, Rogue has figured out exactly how to give those late nights and even earlier mornings the supercharge that we all need. Rogue Energy is a low-calorie, no-sugar energy formula that is the perfect alternative to sugar-filled canned energy drinks and sodas. Every formula Rogue Energy produces is designed with optimal levels of high-quality ingredients and no chalky textures. Again, we don't want that. We don't want that. Being the only gaming drink company in the world with four unique product lines to suit your task at hand, Rogue Energy strives to improve the in-game performance of gamers, streamers, and content creators around the world. Now, I know that we've been riding this train for a long time. You might be tired of us talking about this. You might not be tired of us. You might want to just support us anyways. And you know what? For those that do support us, we love you. But the best way to support us right now is to grab yourself a big old cup of Joe. When I say Joe, I mean this Rogue Energy stuff. I need you waking up first thing in the morning with a big old stretch. You get a big old stretch going. Oh, wow. You grab your Rogue Energy cup. Okay, you dip that bad boy, you just scoop that bad boy right on there. You give that bad boy a shaky-daky, you know what I'm saying? And then you're out the dang door, okay? You need this beverage in your life. I cannot express that enough. You can head on over to RogueEnergy.com and use code GKRAKEN for 10% off any purchase of shaker or formula tub of your choosing. That's GKRAKEN for 10% off any shaker or formula tub that you would like. Now, back to the episode. Shaky danky, baby. What's happening? Shaky danky, baby. Let's go. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for hanging out with us. We appreciate y'all. We love you guys. We love you guys for hanging out with us. Garrick, tell them what they get next for hanging out with us.
Next, we have Hands on Deck.
Garrick, what is Hands on Deck?
Hands on Deck is our hands-on segment where we talk about what we've actually been watching or playing and viewing with our eye holes this past week, more or less. And we talk about it with you guys. That's more or less, this is the gist. It's the cool things we actually do.
Yeah, the fun stuff that we do in between the bullshit that you guys have to experience with us here. I love it. Garrick, what have you been playing or watching this week, my guy?
Look, at the beginning of the show, I mentioned I played hooky from work yesterday. Take care of some errands and some other things. Well, the other things was a very long, heavily emotional investing one Dying Light 2, which resulted in its completion.
Let's go, Garrick. Let's go.
After 81 hours, completed the campaign for Dying Light 2. I am very, very close to max level at this point. I still have lots of challenges and Easter eggs and like fun weapons and like side quests that I still have plenty to do. That shit's probably going to stay perma installed on the Xbox. It's not going anywhere.
Of course.
And then, absolutely, man. So now I need to get you and Devin to beat it. Dude, the second half of the story. The second half. Like, we're so close to the point where it literally just goes, and just takes, the story literally just takes off.
Yeah. Okay. It takes off. Okay.
And the way they ended it was like, it actually makes sense. For one, you're just like, yep, I understand, like, this would have made sense. I probably would have made the same call as, like, Aiden's character. And it opens it up to, look, they said they're going to support this game for 5 years after its launch. And the ending sets up some potentially really cool things that they can do that can really expand on the already growing, like, universe that is Dying Light. It got a little twisty at the end. There were some things that I didn't expect with the story. Not like anything necessarily groundbreaking, but it definitely surprised me. There were some butt-clenchy moments. Honestly, like, it's just, I can't wait. I cannot wait for the new story DLC in September, which, from what I understand, doesn't take place after the story, but it runs, like, parallel to the main story and tie in the timeline.
Oh, okay.
So it's like a, parallel sort of deal. So I'm really interested to check that out and see where that goes. They've already, like, released, like, a bunch of new parkour challenges. And there was a brief update where I logged in last to play yesterday. And there's, like, new mutations for, like, the special infected stuff. Like, they have, like, elemental effects and stuff now. You can run into those in the wild. And that's kind of rad.
Right.
Dude, honestly, I loved this game. It was a great sequel. Like, it wasn't perfect. Had some issues at launch. There were some annoying bugs. There's still some annoying bugs that I'm dealing with. Fucking double time quest. Techland, I swear to God. Fix the double time quest. I'm so tired of logging in to see that quest pop up on my every time I log in. It haunts me. I've completed it 3 times. I'm not doing it anymore. You've gotten all the time. Anyways, it's not even a big bug. It's just annoying, and I'm tired of seeing it. But, like, there were some, like, death loop bugs and stuff that were, like, breaking people's save files. They fixed all that. They've got the 60 FPS mode that's gotten some visual improvements on the Series S. So it's, like, looking a little bit better and running a little bit smoother. Techland does the thing where they really do a great job at, like, long-term supporting their games. They literally just released a brand new update for the original Dying Light game, like, 2 weeks ago.
Oh, shit. Okay.
Like, fresh content. Like, literally, like, and they're still doing, like, that's, like, one of the things that they're really good at. Like, they maintain and, like, support their games for a good long while. And, I'm so looking forward to the future of Dying Light 2. I love it. Like, I know Elden Ring's probably the objectively better game, but fuck me. Like, this is my game of the year so far. I loved it. It was pure joy for me to play this game.
So how are you feeling on, like, the two sort of coexisting? Like, which one do you like more?
See, it's tough. Because if I had to just, like, out the gate, like, initial impressions, I had more fun with this one as, like, a sequel. And sure. I think a lot of that had to do with the changes they did to, like, the nighttime system. I'm a bitch boy, and I don't, like, so, like, I, as much as I love horror games, and I do love them despite my bitchness, and so, like, Dying Light 1 was way scarier, and I love it for that, because they'll never change that, right? It'll always be that scarier, gritty game.
Right.
But this one, the night felt like its own ecosystem. In this game, and, like, I felt like the rooftop traversal, and, like, just the way that, like, there was gardens all over the roofs, and, like, this one just felt like it was just an improvement on all the things that I enjoyed so much about the first one. Even if some of the story beats, because the story in the first one, I will say, was not the most exciting either. Like, it was pretty cut and dry. Sure, like, you saw where it was gonna go. You're like, yep, this is gonna go this way. You kind of know what's gonna happen. And then it does, and you're just like, yep, okay. Cool. The expansion did a better job of, like, kind of storytelling with the storytelling beats. And it, like, it improved on the game as a whole. But, like, as of right now, I would say I like Dying Light 2 more. I really, okay. It felt more cohesive. It improved on all the things. The improvements on the parkour specifically, oh, like, yeah. It's so yeah. smooth now. It is much fun to use the grappling hook. And, like, the paraglider, everything's satisfying. The parkour combat is lit in this game. Like, so, dude, I hardly use weapons. I am drop kicking motherfuckers left and right when I play.
That's,
it's just, I can't.
You're not wrong. You definitely do. Love, like
I do. Like, tell me how many, like, Devin's out there just swinging, and you're, like, supporting everybody, and I'm just like, guys, watch this, and then I just like literally like grapple tackle somebody off a 6-story building down to the ground, and I was like, you guys see this shit? Like, that's, dude, I love it. Like, I love it. It creates such cool moments. The moment-to-moment gameplay is pure adrenaline for me. Like, because I'm afraid of like zombies and shit. Like, I love that. I love it, yeah. But like, I'm afraid of that sort of crap, and like, I'm massively afraid of heights.
Yeah,
massively
right.
afraid
retweet,
of heights.
Retweet.
So this is like the only time I'm ever gonna get to live out like that.
Yeah, that right. fantasy. the hyper fantasy, right? Yeah, sure.
Exactly.
Sure.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Dude, that's. I know how you feel because like that's exactly who I am on that boat too. My thing is like, you took on a very daunting task, right? Like I couldn't take it on my own, you know what I mean? And like you doing it on your own is just it's fucking bravo, man. Like, because I could never do that on my own, dude. Not with that game, I'll tell you that. Like, it's a fun game, but like there's some moments, man. There's some moments that I'm like, mm-mm, no.
You're like, that's
I'm,
it, dude. The windmills still make my ass like straight up, just like.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it literally just straight pucker, dude. Like, it is. I can't tell you how many times, like, whenever we play that game and we're like off camera, like, we go to like make like a parkour jump, right? And like, I think I'm gonna miss and I'm doing this shit.
Yep.
Like, get there. Get there. And then, like, you start to like miss the ledge and then he grabs it the last second. You're like, dude. Like, and like, the falling, like, I don't know about you, but like, it like when you fall in that game, I like tense up and I'm just like, this is gonna hurt,
yeah,
dude.
Yeah.
Especially when you know it's like too high for you to like do like the little roller thing out of, you're like, oh, I'm gonna feel this one. You're like, a bandage is gonna be needed after this, my friend.
Yep. The one that always was for me was like jumping off like a roof to get to a ledge on like another building. I would feel my body like do that like as I'm going for the ledge, and like
dude it's the wildest. Or dude, in this game they like added a mechanic where like you can like grab but like you still slip, and like so you'll fall a little bit before
and
that shit gets me every time. I don't know, there's like, and there's some things about that game where like it's got some little things that just like I just capture my heart. Like specifically, and I've talked about this before, but like it's worth talking about again. If you get like a good parkour run going anywhere in the city, there's like this really small immersive thing. I think it's probably my favorite thing in the game, and it's real small. It's small.
Yeah, sure.
But Aiden actually gets like excited when you're doing a good run,
right.
And like he starts to like breathe, like not heavily, like tired. Like he's just like,
the, like
yeah, and he like, and he starts, he gets into it.
Yeah,
yeah, and like, he starts into it, and he like feels it, and it's like it feels really immersive, and like if you get it going, and like you get like a good jump,
yeah,
and like he like kills it, he'll like exclamate to himself. He was just like, he'll say like, yeah, like that was a fucking good one, like, and like, dude, he was just like, yo, did you see that? Let's go. And like he says that, and I don't know, it's like it's probably my favorite small thing about the game because you spend so much time running.
Right,
that
right.
like it makes Aiden feel like an alive character, like an alive protagonist, mm-hmm. And it does it for me,
dude. That's fucking rad. Griff, thank you for the subscription, doggy dog. We love you and Lego, you know what I'm saying? What's happening, Griffy baby? What's Lego. Happening? Oh, Garrick, so I have a thing that I watch, okay, a little thing that I watched here, and it's a very special movie called Moonfall, my friend. And it is a it was available to rent on Amazon Prime, so I was like, fuck it, let's rent it, let's give it a swing. And I'll tell you what, my friend, I don't think I've regretted renting a movie as much in a while. Ladies and gentlemen,
not where I thought you were gonna go.
Moonfall is a science fiction movie starring Patrick Wilson, Halle Berry, and one John Bradley from Game of Thrones. He plays Sam in Game of Thrones. And, God damn it. Halle Berry and Patrick Wilson play as two astronauts that had experienced a moment outside of the moon, in orbit of the moon. A alien phenomenon happens to them that accidentally has one of their peeps get killed, and they come back down to Earth. They try to explain everything and nobody fucking believes them until 10 years later the moon starts to come off of its rotation and comes hurling towards Earth. And this movie is about them trying to figure out why the moon is doing this while also trying to survive this apocalyptic event happening because the moon controls so many things on Earth. The issues that I had in this movie is you have to suspend a lot of disbelief because this is one of those movies where like it's focused on like a small number of people that are directly involved with the United States government. And they do things that the United States government would never in their fucking lifetime allow them to fucking do.
And so you're like, this would fly never.
It is just the most like perfect example of just bonkers bullshit. In a way that, like, not even, like, Fast and the Furious can get fucking wrong. Because at least they own the bonkers bullshit, right? They own it. This is, like,
they
very
do.
Much,
they
like,
lean into it.
This is very much them being, like, we want to be a science fiction movie, but we also want to be high fucking action. And there are some moments that are, like, dope, right? But it is a slow fucking burn to get there, my man, because it does not start popping off until, like, the third fucking act of this movie, and everything up to that point is just, it's just fucking exposition, right? It's exposition while everything around them is being fucking destroyed. It's like, I don't care about your personal lives. If you're going to commit to being an alien movie, I need you to actually commit to being an alien movie, right? Because like they're so split on what the fuck this movie wants to be. And I was just like you have such good fucking actors in this movie. Patrick Wilson is fucking incredible,
like
dude.
Wilson, yeah.
John Bradley is incredible. Halle Berry has had her times, but she's also incredible.
She's had her times,
okay?
Okay, so my question to you about this is, like, I went ahead and I looked this up on good old Rotten Tomatoes, because this is, like, a new film, right? This is, like, a 2022
mm-hmm,
film.
Mm-hmm.
And so we'll start with the audience score on this one. The audience score on this is actually 70%.
Mm-hmm.
The critic score, however, is 37%.
Okay. Like, listen.
Which one do you feel is more accurately represented?
Because here's the deal, Garrick. We've been doing this long enough now that we have a general idea of what a good movie consists of. Okay, like, because we're actively having to think about that, we get it now. We understand. We can comprehend good storytelling, good character arcs, scene building, character building, all the stuff, right? All the fucking things. And this movie does none of them well. Not a single one of those things does this movie do fucking well, man. And it bums me out because, like, it has moments that I'm like, oh, fuck yeah, dude, that was dope, right? That was fucking sick, man. Or, like, there's some visual moments, like, oh, that's fucking dope, right? That's tight as shit. I just wish that was in literally any other movie, right? Any other movie. Like, put that in, like me and Marlene. I don't know, that movie about the dog with Owen Wilson. Anyways.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
It just, man, yeah, it's fine. It's a fine fucking movie at best, right? Like, I would give it a 6 out of 10 tops. Tops. That's like giving it some benefit because
that,
Patrick Wilson.
Say, that seems like kind of a stretch even, dude. Like, this doesn't seem like it was just... This is, like, one of those movies that, like, you would end up thinking it was a good movie if you, like, came in halfway through and it was on cable and you're only, like, half watching it.
Yeah, 100%. Like, this is something that, like, will be fun, like, when you just so happen to see it pop up on something one day for free and you're like, oh, yeah, I never watched that,
when
did I?
When it's on a service, yeah.
Yeah.
Don't spend money on it, though.
Don't spend money on this. Don't. Right. It's not worth the $5 yet. It's not worth the $5 yet, I'll tell you what. God, it still is actively hurting my brain to think about this movie because there's so many moments that I was like, what? What? Like, that would... No!
It's like a 2-hour movie, too, isn't it?
Yeah, it's long, man.
We ain't never getting that shit back. That's gone forever.
Yeah, I know, man. I feel like... it had some cool shit, man. It had some cool shit, but at the end of the day, Patrick Wilson wasn't enough to carry this fucking fucking sad movie, man. It's a fucking sad excuse for a goddamn film, I'll tell you. I'll tell you what. Garrick, now that we're done complaining about the likeness of one Moonfall, and how apparently if the moon like goes off orbit, the entire ocean will drown the world, I guess. Garrick, what do we have for people next?
Well, you better protect your neck, because we are headed to the gallows.
Let's go, my friends. And everybody, tonight for the gallows, we are talking Evil Dead, the game, the review. Let's fucking go, okay.
The review.
Garrick, my man, we're going to do things a little bit differently than our usual review content, because this is kind of our first video game review we've done in a while.
It's been a minute. It's been a minute. We've done like an official video game review anyhow.
Yes, exactly. And we kind of talked it over, and we're like, hey, we've done lots of movie reviews. Why haven't we done any game reviews? Let's fucking do it, right? So tonight we're talking to you guys about it. Because it is a video game review instead of a movie review, we're not going to give you guys a trivia. We're not going to give you guys like all the director stuff and all that good stuff. What we're going to do is give you guys an open forum review. That's a lot of fun. We're going to inform you of the good stuff, the bad stuff, and everything else in between. Hope you guys stick around for it. Garrick, what are your thoughts of Evil Dead the game?
Initial thought, and this is just like literally like this is probably the most fun I've had with like an asymmetrical PvP game.
Mm-hmm.
It's a little different in the sense that it's PvE VP.
Yeah.
The presentation of the killer side of the asymmetrical combat is actually like really enjoyable to play through. I find it really kind of exciting and fun. I like that there's kind of like a set limit to match. It's like it's one of those games like you go into it and you're like, all right, I'm gonna spend 30 minutes in this match, and it will be that at maximum you're spending like a half hour here,
right?
And so
right.
It's like one of those games that's like it's got like a good, I just want to play like a quick match of like Evil Dead real quick, and you can jump in on like the killer side or the survivor side and still like have like a good like half an hour experience, be like, all right, time to go do whatever, and then bounce.
Right.
That's probably some of the things I liked about it the most. It's definitely like incomplete's not the right word, because it's complete in its current form. It's just missing some things and some quality of life features and some accessibility features that like are kind of commonplace these days that I think I would just kind of like to see.
That aren't
in place at the moment. I don't know if they've spoken about like addressing any of that or what their plans are for the future, but
sure.
There's some accessibility things that it's a little lacking. Settings in the game are real bare bones, even on PC, not a lot going on there,
right?
Which I know is kind of a drawback. I know it's missing some widescreen capability stuff, narrows down their market a smidge. I've seen quite a few complaints about that. A lot of people have widescreen monitors these days on the PC.
Yep.
That's kind of like the equivalent of like, you know, having a big screen TV back in the day, but only being able to watch something in full screen.
Right.
So,
right.
You know,
right.
And it's kind of the same feeling. So it's a little frustrating. We're just like, I paid for this shit to do its job, and like your shit's not compatible. But I don't know, like fun factor, out of this world, dude. Like it's just a really fun game, and the gameplay is really tight. It's actually really smooth, and everything that's in the game at the moment feels very polished, and at least from what I've experienced anyhow.
I definitely agree. I think they did an incredible job of making this game very silky smooth. Like it is like, it looks phenomenal all things considered. It looks more than a $40 game, right? It looks way better than a usual $40 game. The graphics are so nice. The character movement is so smooth. The enemy movement super smooth. The environment, like the particle effects and stuff, are dope. Like this game looks really, really fucking good. There's just some like quality of life stuff, like you said, that just kind of like needs a little bit of work. And I guess that's kind of like my only real gripe that I have about it, is that there's just a couple little tiny things, like the the way the cars control when you're driving the cars, the way that, like, when you go to attack an enemy, the fact that there's not a lock-on system shocks me, because this game is very, very third-person melee combat a majority of the time, and there's not a lock-on system.
Even a soft lock where it just redirects you to the enemy would be fine. Yeah. In this setting, right? It doesn't even need to be a hard lock. Just give me the ability to even a quick turn would be rad. Why is there no quick turn even?
Right.
But there's some things. I think my biggest gripe at the moment that I find just really annoying is as our resident, I'm gonna host the game, dude.
Right.
There's no persistent lobby. Every time we finish a match, we have to resend out invites. Yep. That's just a tad annoying. When you sometimes play video games for 3 or 4 hours at a time,
right? Yeah. Now, granted, we don't want to sit here and make it sound like this game's a heaping pile of shit or something like that. Because like you said, we've been having a lot of fun with this game. This game is such a good party game and such a good multiplayer experience that it's such a good multiplayer experience that if you don't have the complete multiplayer experience, can kind of bog down that experience for you a little bit, but you're still able to have some fun, right? So it's you and I had that night, it was just us two, and we had the time of our fucking lives, man. We had so much fun playing that game with you and I.
It was great.
And then playing it again with me, you, and Devin, and we had the fourth rando, Devin being Devin. He was like, this is getting out of hand, right? And we were like, nah, dude, we're fine. That's fine. It's cool.
All good.
It's all good, dog. You know, we're still getting experience points. It's all right. But just, I think the part that I'm most impressed by is that they found a way to take everything that we really love in Left 4 Dead and everything that everybody loves in Dead by Daylight, and they sort of found this happy medium between the two to give us this really smooth gameplay that feels almost Red Dead Redemption style combat that just feels very over the shoulder immersive, not immersive because it's FPS, because it's not an FPS, but immersive in the way that you get in modern day PlayStation games, right? Modern day PlayStation first party story games. And they still made that a multiplayer experience. And that was incredible the first night that we played it. We were like, dude, this feels really nice, man. You're running around everywhere. Combat doesn't feel sluggish or anything. You actively feel like you're actually doing something. I do kind of wish that they had some more combat animations per weapon and so on and so forth. But this is the smallest gripe ever. But the thing that I want to make sure that we point at first and foremost is this is the first game that we've gone into Splash Damage with. And for anybody who doesn't know, that's our Friday night multiplayer video game stream. This is the first Splash Damage game we've gone into in a really long time that was done.
Was it fucking broken?
No server issues. Nothing was broken. Nothing was fucked up. We were in queue. And once tutorial stuff was finished and whatnot, we were like, boom, boom, I'll send you an invite. Send me the invite. We were in, we were on, and we were gone. And it was perfection. The smoothest online multiplayer experience I think we've had probably ever since we started Good Kraken, dog.
Dude, it's honestly that's probably one of the things I think that most initially impressed the both of us. We're just like, holy shit. We didn't have to spend 45 minutes getting the game to game. So while we do have critiques and stuff about things that we would like to see in the future, everything that is actually present in the game at its current works amazingly.
Yes.
All functions great. The functionality and it works. The game just works the way it's was intended. Everything, it's not broke. It's not a broke ass game. Which it sucks that this is even something we have to be.
Dude, no, exactly. In 2022, it fucking sucks, right? But anyways, continue.
But dude, it's just amazing to not have a bad experience at launch to sour that initial gameplay experience. Especially because look, I love Devin. But Devin's got like an hour long window where like if that shit doesn't work, he's like, this game sucks. And then we have to spend like yep. 10 yep. hours convincing yep. him otherwise. Yep. And I'm yep. okay with that because I will stick it out every time.
Sure. 100%. Like, I'm with you, dog.
Right. But like Dying Light 2 comes to mind immediately. this game is up. I'm sorry. I'm not talking shit on you because you're not here, Devin. I love you. I'm sorry. I love you.
I am. That's my number one rule. I don't talk shit about you unless you're not here. Anyways.
I love you. But then, dude, it was amazing to have a smooth launch. Like, to get, like just know, like, when we got into the lobby, I was just like, all right, I'm sending you the invite. And you're like, we're like waiting. And you're like, did you get it? You're like, invite received. And I'm like, you're like, join in the lobby. You're like, all right, I'm joining the lobby. And like you pop in, you're like, I'm in. Or like, I'm starting the match. You're like, you're starting the match.
You're spot on, dude. And like, I think the coolest thing too is that like, it was such a good experience getting together and playing this game, like having no bumps in the road getting into the actual game, that it actually like added on points to the game for us. Like, it was like,
absolutely.
Like it was the first thing we mentioned. We were like, holy shit. Like we got in here no problem. Like we're starting a match right now as we speak, right? And it was like going into it, and we just within 20 minutes of like technically 5 minutes after I finished the tutorial, because the first 15 was mm-hmm. me doing the fucking tutorial. After getting into the initial thing, and within 5 minutes we were in a match, getting started playing the actual game. And I think that is probably the best thing this game does. Period. But it's also like the best benefit that this game has, because regardless of any jankiness, any little tiny things that we have that are like caveats towards this game or whatsoever, that alone makes this game worth playing. Because like along with what you do get in this game, with the access that you have to be able to play this game with your friends so easily, I can't recommend this fucking game enough, dog. Like, I know you and I have been advocates for this since Friday, dude, but like,
we really have been pushing so hard. Like, I want so desperately to yeah. have a 5-person party in a private lobby mm-hmm. with the homies. Like, mm-hmm. I want to do it. I want us to take turns playing as the Kandaren demon. I want everybody to do it. I need it.
Yep, dog. Well, I got Chase on board. Chase is on board for Friday, and I know Devin is probably going to want to make up for, you know, today, whatever, you know, but we have an opportunity to make it happen. We could potentially make it happen, okay? This game is so much fucking fun, guys. Like, this game is so much goddamn fun, dude. Like if you like the experience of Dead by Daylight, but, like, you hate the logistics that come with the burdens that come with Dead by Daylight, such as a la server issues, out the ass, not being able to fight back, just constantly feeling like people are toxic as fuck in the game. This yeah. game has some ways that like you could get griefed, but like it's not enough to like directly impact the experience, right? Like you're yeah. actively able to like take reins of the situation and go for it. Like, it's not like a thing where like if another person is just like ballistically out-leveled compared to us, that we have zero chance, because the game does take like a form of skill. And like, if you time everything correctly and you go about things correctly and you move forward correctly and you're good about finding things and you're very, very experienced at what you're doing, it doesn't fucking matter. You're still going to have a good fucking time, dude. I cannot recommend this enough. Griff says, people are toxic and Dead by Daylight? What do you mean? I only bait my entire team so they die. Griff, you're toxic dog. You're fucking toxic dog. Garrick, I don't know, man. Do you have any like sort of wheelhouse thoughts like kind of coming off of that? Like, I know that we kind of basically covered like the main stuff here, but like obviously there's things with like character leveling up, for example, right? How are you liking the skill trees in this game? Oh, you're muted. You're muted. Okay.
Oh no.
Oh, there you go. No, you're good now. You're good now. I can hear you now. Go ahead.
Okay, cool. I was worried my mic did this thing where it gets the shits.
Yeah, sure.
Dude, honestly, after I figured out how it fucking worked, because there's like no tutorial for that part, and I didn't think to read the tooltip on the bottom. Fuck me, right? Mm-hmm. It's pretty clever. Like, it's got like it's a little grindy. If you're losing a lot, and it can kind of feel a little burden-ish to level up the number of characters there are, and there are quite a few on the Survivor side, at least.
And starting out with 10. Starting out with 10. So, like...
Yeah, and you can unlock at least... I think they unlock 1, 2, 3, 4 more. Mm-hmm. Like, one more for each class category.
Sure.
I think it's a little grindy. Like, it's not bad. I just think, and maybe it's because I'm not quite super experienced in the game, so I don't have a lot of wins. If you could get pretty deep into a match, like, and still lose, you still get like 10,000 experience. You definitely, like, they definitely, like, really, really, like, heavily reward you for, like, a win. I think one of the big things that's, like, worth mentioning about this, it's just, like, the franchise that the game's kind of based around.
Yeah, sure.
Which is, like, a big thing that I feel like makes it a little different from, like, the other asymmetrical games. Like, the main thing being that, like, this whole thing is based off of, like, the Evil Dead franchise.
Right.
Which is Sam Raimi. He is the brainchild of that franchise. And one Bruce Campbell, goddamn. And he voices 4 or 5 different versions of himself in this video game. And they brought back like all of the iconic demons from Army of Darkness, Evil Dead 2, and Ash vs. Evil Dead the series. And like those are the characters you get to play as like in the on the demon side. And they have like some of their iconic like lines and their animations and stuff are like some of their like iconic stuff. Like Ash's jump scream is his scream he does in Army of Darkness, like his little thing he does. And then like Henrietta's got like a couple of like her really iconic lines from the film. And it's like, I don't know, it's like, it's really like, it's super campy because that's kind of like what Evil Dead is. Like, it's like a campy, like almost like a parody of like horror films.
Yes.
And if you really enjoy that, like about like the Evil Dead, like that, it translates really well to this medium. And like it feels Evil Dead. It really does. Like they do a good job like capturing the essence. I'd like to maybe get like some more variety of voice lines and stuff in the future. But
yeah, no, I had to echo what you were saying is like, yeah, for sure. I think this odes very well. I think it fan services very well. I think it does like for just kind of being a base like $40 game, like they do a good job of being like, hey, if you like games like Dead by Daylight, play this. If you like Evil Dead, play this. If you like horror games, play this. Like it kind of offers a whole bunch for a bunch of different people. Yeah. But its fan service to Evil Dead is like so cleverly done, like everything from like the possessing trees to the way that the can't, like when you're controlling the demon, when you're the demon facing off against the survivors, how like that first person perspective of the demon looks the exact same as it's presented in the Evil Dead movies, like traveling through the forest and like zooming through and stuff like that. They fucking nailed the fan service in this, man. Like, I think, like, honestly, like, here's the deal. I haven't played the campaign missions yet. So, like, I don't know too much about, like, how those react to it. I do know about, like, the environmental stuff, the way the characters are, the game as a whole, like, as its core game. Do you feel like it's still fan service as well in the campaign? Like, what are these story missions like?
Definitely. I'll just kind of talk about the first mission because that's like the entry point, right?
Yeah.
With no spoilers, unless you haven't seen Evil Dead for some reason.
Right.
But most of the story missions that kind of take place, so like there, it's like episodic, but really, it's just reliving like highlight moments from the films. That's exactly what the story missions are. The first one is like literally like you go dig up like your dead wife Linda's like possessed head from the movie, and she's like talking to you like she does, and like basically trying it's that scene, like it's that set of scenes. And then like they kind of like branch out from there, and like that's how you get like the funeral attire stuff, and like they add on, that's how you unlock the characters, but like they Griff and Chaz and Evil Dead's over 30 years old, they haven't seen it, it's their own fault. Amen to that. Well, I mean, there's new stuff to the franchise.
Sure, sure.
There's newer entries, but anyways. And so, but no, it still holds up. Like, it kind of gives you like a fun little like recapturing of the moments from the films. It's been a while since I've seen some of them, so like some of the memories are a little fuzzy. But I like all the like the chemo, and so it's like, yeah, I kind of remember this a little bit, and like where you're going to and some of the environmental like the set pieces that like they have Ash walk through is kind of the same. And I was like, yep, you're like, this feels like Evil Dead. Like they share some of the voice lines, and you know, it's fun. Like it's a good little like. It's like walk down memory lane, and they're like, oh, since you did that, here's some rewards for the actual like fun, like the game that you bought to play.
Yeah. What I want to ask you next, kind of moving outside of that, is what do you see them doing in the future with this? Like, do you think that like their path is really just the same path as Dead by Daylight? They release new demons or release new characters, or do you think they'll add more story shit too? Where do you see them going with this?
See, now this is what's kind of interesting, because from what I understand, this is kind of supposed to like exist as like a small expansion in a way to like kind of provide and expand on some of like the existing like franchise and world building that Evil Dead has done. I'm curious to see like what shape that will take. There's definitely more characters they can add. I don't know what they're going to do about as like far as demons and stuff go. They have kind of the iconic, like the three most iconic numbers in there. They do have story DLC planned. They do. I'm sure they're going to add more survivors. I'm just curious to see if they kind of keep it isolated, or if this will end up being like a Dead by Daylight experience where like they maybe bring in some other franchises. But since it's kind of an expansion on the mythos, as like in like the ultimate multiplayer experience, I'd really like to see them just add on to the stuff that already exists. Like, give us more of those wacky B characters as, like, survivors and stuff. Like, I like that. Like, I like that shit. Like, give me some random, like crackpot character, like, nobody gave two shits about. Yeah. Make him super busted. Right. Chuck him in there. Right. And, like, let's, like, just make it fun. Like, really lean into, like, the things that makes Evil Dead enjoyable to, like, the fans of the franchise. And just roll with it and keep it going for a while.
Yeah. Absolutely, dude. Absolutely. All right, man. Well, what is your rating for Evil Dead the game, my friend? So far.
I think I am going to give this crisp 7.5.
My man, absolutely 100% agree. Yeah, this is a 7.5 game. I mean, like, it does the things that it does well, incredibly, incredibly fucking well. The things that it needs to work on, maybe they'll touch on it, maybe they won't. There's some accessibility stuff that they could probably do, like, a lot better. That holds it back for me a little bit. It does get a little bit redundant. I do hope that they put in some different game modes in the future, and that'll then give me some extra points for them later on. But for right now, for what it is, yeah, I think it's a 7.5 ass game. I think it's a lot of fun. People should play this. People should give it a try, because it is a fun time.
It's great for its price point too.
For
40 bucks, like you can get quite a few hours out of this, especially if you want to like grind up the characters and you have like some friends to really like enjoy like the multiplayer part of the game.
Right.
Like it's a buy. It's totally a buy. It's just the fun factor outweighs like all the gripes.
Yeah.
Like it's just a fun game.
Yeah, and I would not recommend it if it was any more than $40, to be completely honest with you. But yeah, because that price point works very well in tandem to what they're actually offering, I think it's totally fair. Like, people should, if you have $40 and you want to get a video game, play this fucking game. If you have some friends you want to play it with, play this fucking goddamn game. This is a great game to play with fucking friends, dude. If you're a fan of Evil Dead, if you like horror stuff, so on and so forth, like we were talking about earlier, definitely give this game a fair swing. Garrick, I'm stoked that you and I are just out here hunting Deadites, my guy. Just out here just dude, living our it. Best Evil Dead life, my man. But we got to talk about our schedule for the next week. Wednesday, tomorrow, my friends, we are doing Ocean Shrine Storytime with yours truly. And tomorrow, we are playing Vampire Masquerade Blood Hunt. I'm going to get that, and we're going to give that a try, because that game has been blowing up with popularity lately. I want to give it a swing. especially because it is supposed to be a dark vampire gritty version of a top 10 video game of all time, Fortnite. And I'm interested to see like what they have to offer in this game.
The traversal, and it's actually pretty fucking cool, like being able to climb the building. I've actually played it. I played it a little bit. It's
because you got it during the pre-screen, right?
Like the trial. Yep, when they did like the little initial trial after the announcement of the game.
Marvin says, God, I hate you. Listen, man, you guys can deny it all you want, but I'm here for it, all right? And then Thursday, we have another live recording of The Shipwreck Show for our patrons over on patreon.com/goodkrakenshow. You guys can come in, you can watch that. For those of you watching live, please join our Discord. You can be a part of that on there. We have a channel in there called Shipwreck Submissions, where if you are a Twitch subscriber, you can write into the show and we will pick amongst your questions the three that we like best for us to talk about on the show. You guys have an opportunity to be a part of the conversation. If you are on our Patreon, you'd rather do it on there. Come to the show, talk to us live, hang out with us for that. It is so much fun. And then this Friday, we have another Splash Damage, and then we are playing again Evil Dead the fucking game. You guys missed it last Friday. You guys can come with us this Friday and hang out with us. Let us sell you on this goddamn game, man. Let's sell you. And I tell you what, they better start paying us, man.
we are really champion, like being champions for this game, like for real. Like it's been a fun one. Also, I don't know if you caught earlier, but Morbid in the chat said he gets paid on Friday. So I think, look, my math's not very good, but you, me, Devin, Chase, Morbid, that's a full private lobby right there. That's what I need in my life.
Ding, 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 you know what I'm saying? Morbid, let's talk, baby boy, you know what I'm saying? Be here for that. You do not want to miss that, especially with a five-person squad. It's going to get real redonkulous in here. We're excited for it. Now, then on Saturday, we have another Good Kraken podcast, where this time we're talking fictional characters we want to spend a day with. Ladies and gentlemen, please let us know your thoughts on Evil Dead the game. Let us know if you want to play it. Let us know if you're interested in it. Let us know if you're going to get it, because we told you that you should get it. If you have played it, tell us what you think. It would give us your rating as well. And it has been so much fun doing another video game review with you, Garrick. What a fucking time to be alive, man. What a time to be a gamer, my dude. You know what I'm saying?
Good.
Goddamn, son. Good. And guys, man, I'm fucking stoked. This has been the Good Kraken Podcast, your choice for all the nerdy video game and pop media news, reviews, and discussions that you wanted to hear, live every Tuesday at 7 p.m. and Saturday at 12 p.m. right here at twitch.tv/goodkrakenshow. If you enjoyed the show, you can head on over to patreon.com/goodkrakenshow, where you can submit questions and topics to the show, get exclusive post-show content, and have early access to episodes before they go live on podcasts and video services across the digital sea. You can also support us by going to our YouTube channel, by clicking that beautiful bell and big red button, or by subscribing to our podcast channel by searching Good Kraken with an exclamation mark and leaving a review there. We got to get going, y'all. But until next time, my friends, be good to each other.
Motherfucking flat ass Pepsi, dude. Shit.
Groovy, baby.